Ladies and gentlemen, it's a tremendous pleasure to open this, the 7th World Cup here at Lord's, the home of cricket. I wish everyone the very best. I know it's going to be a tremendous tournament, and let this tremendous carnival of cricket now begin.
The Prime Minister opens the 7th World Cup with the flags of the 12 competing nations decked out across the outfield during the opening ceremony. 5 previous winners, the West Indies twice, India, Australia, Pakistan and Sri Lanka, victorious 3 years ago in Lahore when their attack at all costs approach led them to a 7-wicket triumph over Australia in the final. Well, England took the field today knowing they've always reached the last 4 when the host nation, but 3 times beaten finalists, could they go one better this time? Well, good evening. It's going to be a long and exciting haul. 42 matches between now and the final at Lord's on June the 20th. And over the years, there have been all sorts of different formats in this competition. And this is what the organisers came up with this time around. 2 groups of 6, with England arguably in the toughest section. The top 3 in each group go through to the next stage, the so-called Super Sixes. And every match in this round robin will be crucial because the points are carried forward to the second phase. And after that, it's the semi-finals and then the final. Well, offering his verdict on what's going to happen over the next few weeks will be England all-rounder Chris Lewis. And this really was an absolutely vital match because this is a very, very competitive sextet and neither side could afford to lose. That's the England side and their worst-kept secret was confirmed just before the start when Nasser Hussain was announced as Alex Stewart's opening partner in place of Nick Knight. Ian Austin, in his own words, from journeyman county player to World Cup starter, would open the bowling with Darren Goff. Sri Lanka, the holders, at full strength, with some of the most dashing stroke players in the game, Jayasuriya and Da Silva, and of course the most controversial bowler in world cricket, Muralitharan, whose action remains a constant source of debate. Well, under leaden skies, England won a very important toss and elected to bowl. The umpires you can see from India and South Africa. And joining our commentators, Richie Benno, Jonathan Agnew and Jack Bannister, were Mike Atherton, Barry Richards, Dermot Reeve and the former Sri Lankan test player, Salia Ahangama. Here we are at Lord's then, 10 to 11 in the morning, and the World Cup about to start.
All in readiness, first ball of the 1999 World Cup, Goff to Jayasuriya. One on the board, no ball, and... and that's precisely what he's done. A big hit, straight down the ground, a 6... to win the match for England, this first World Cup encounter. A victory for England in the first of these matches, the host country coming out on top over Sri Lanka. And that was when they were set a target of 205 to win. The 2 batsmen out, Nasser Hussain 14, Alex Stewart 88, with Graham Hicks 73 not out and Graham Thorpe 13. They won with 19 balls to spare.
So straightforward in the end, the second wicket stand between Stewart and Hick worth 125, as England won with more than 3 overs to spare, as Richie said just there. As far as the Sri Lankan bowling is concerned, Jayasuriya taken to the cleaners, and the Sri Lankan attack really unable to pose any real threats. So the margin in the end was 8 wickets, probably quite a close call for man of the match, but in the end the judges chose the England captain.
Very well done, Alec. A great team performance, that, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's very, very solid performance. We'd had 3 very good warm-up games against the counties, and then we carried on that very good form today, and hopefully that will continue.
And it was a good effort of yours to win the toss, I thought.
Yeah, I've been practising over the last couple of weeks, and thankfully called right.
But the bowlers bowled magnificently, I thought. Alan Mullally especially.
Yeah, the wicket did a little bit. We just still got to put a ball in the right place. And Alan Mullally led us and deserved his four wickets and backed up by the rest of them. But a very, very solid performance all round.
And did you think a total of around 200 was just about right to chase?
Yeah, I thought 200 was around a par performance or par score. It seemed around a little bit. We bowled well. 60-odd for four or five, whatever they were. They did well to get 200, but then we knocked them off very, very professionally.
It wasn't particularly easy batting first, was it, out there?
Yeah, it was moving in the morning, but whenever we go into the field, the sun comes out and the wickets settle down.
But Ramesh Kelotanana played really well for you in the middle order as opposed to opening the batting.
Yeah, I thought he batted well after losing five wickets. I think we had to get a partnership going, at least get about 200 runs to make a match of it. And I thought Kalu batted really well, and unfortunately we lost the wickets at the crucial intervals.
Now, as reigning champions, you're certainly not out of this World Cup yet. You'll have to bounce back quickly, though, won't you?
Yeah, very much. I think we played badly. I think England played better than us. But I think we are quite capable of coming back.
Alec, just another quick word. Now, we've talked about the team, but you came into this tournament on a pretty poor set of scores, didn't you? You must be delighted to have batted so well today.
Yeah, very, very pleased. As I said before the tournament started, 1999, I hadn't scored too many runs in one-day internationals. Like I said, I'd worked hard, I backed my ability, and today I was pretty pleased with the way I played.
Now, you couldn't have wished for a better start in the competition. It's been a marvellous performance all round. This has really set England up for the tournament.
Yeah, it is. I'd read a lot. We must win today or else it's the end of English cricket, etc. But we just went out there to do our job and we did it very well. We played one, we've won one.
Well, Chris Lewis here in the studio. Not spectacular, but very emphatic.
Definitely. The sort of game I think the England team actually needed at this time. They've collected the points. They've won very comfortably. I know the spectators or people watching cricket wouldn't be terribly excited. But for the guys, it's a tremendous performance to actually beat Sri Lanka by 8 wickets.
Let's talk about a couple of individuals. Alan Mullally, in particular, your teammate at Leicester, and he got 4 wickets and got an awful lot of lift off the pitch as well.
Yeah, I mean, Al is a big, tall lad, and he puts the ball in the right place on most days. And today there was a bit of movement in the air, a bit of help from the wickets, and as Stewie said, I think 4 for 30 was his just deserved. He bowled really, really well and made all the difference, I think. He ripped the heart out of the Sri Lankan batting.
Well, the two wickets we're seeing here, Jaya Surya and De Silva, and no two bigger scalps than that. And somebody else we're talking about as well, Nasser Hussain. Obviously, a recall to the side to open the batting, but in the field, a very safe pair of hands. That was a crucial catch, wasn't it?
It was, because the Sri Lankans were just actually getting back into the game, and to actually get Ranatunga after he's actually been there a while is a good effort. And, I mean, catches win matches in one-day international. And let's just say that the England team perhaps is not the most sporty team in the field. So to have someone like Nasser there who can actually dive around and take those sort of catches makes all the difference, and as that catch made today.
Was Sri Lanka a bit over-ambitious, do you think, in trying to get too many runs on the board too soon?
I think Sri Lanka, as a batting side, are very ambitious. They go out and they need to put big scores on the actual board because apart from Mully, they actually struggle in the bowling departments. There's no obvious person who will actually come out and take 4 or 5 for. They actually put it in the right place. Therefore, they need to get the 260s, 270s, and maybe even 300s to actually give their bowlers a chance. Once they actually got 200 today, it was plain sailing for England. You know, you could just bat the first 15 overs, not much pressure there, and then just pick up the ones and twos once the field actually goes back.
What signals does that England performance send out to the other teams, the other serious competitors, if you like?
Well, I think over the last sort of few months, England have had a pretty tough time. It's been difficult for them to win matches in Australia and in Sharjah. But the conditions here is actually very different. And I think people like Ian Austin and Mark Elam and all the England bowlers will actually come into their own. In English conditions, the English team will be very hard to beat, especially as they go through the tournament and they keep winning. They build confidence. Semi-finals, I think, very least for England, especially in the conditions. Today was perfect English conditions. It was rainy to start with, overcast, and I think the guys did the job they've actually paid to do.
And how important is it to have the captain playing well so that nobody can throw stones at him and say, yeah, well, maybe he shouldn't be in the side?
Well, it's very important. I think people actually follow the captain's lead, especially Stewie. Stewie likes to lead from the front. He likes to actually go in and actually hit fours and sometimes even actually hit sixes. And I think it's a major day for England today that Stewie actually got in, got 80-odd, didn't necessarily look at his best, but it's a tournament and it's the team that actually peak at the right time. England don't have to play at their best today. I don't think they did. They just need to play well enough to actually get the points.
And a final thought about Sri Lanka, the holders. Do they look like a side that can hang on to their trophy?
Well, Sri Lanka have got quality batsmen. On any day, if Aravinda De Silva gets in or Sanath Jayasuriya, they can actually post 300. I think this World Cup will be more about consistency, and I'm not sure they'll be able to be consistent regularly in the English conditions.
So, good start. Couldn't have asked for more, really.
Perfect start for England.
Brilliant. Chris, thanks very much for coming in.
My pleasure.
A simmering row, which I'm sure your newspapers tomorrow are going to have a great deal about. Shane Warne's written a newspaper column today in which he's accused Arjuna Ranatunga, the Sri Lankan captain, of being not a very nice person and saying the sport will be better off without him. To which Ranatunga has replied this evening, "I'm not worried what Warne says. We come from a 2,500-year-old culture and we know where they come from. This shows more about Shane Warne and the whole of Australian culture than it does about us." To be continued. Anyway, to be continued, the competition, England against Kenya on Tuesday, and the next two matches are tomorrow. Highlights here on BBC Two, India, South Africa at Hove, Zimbabwe against Kenya at Taunton. The carnival is underway, and the hosts are off to a flying start. Good night.
Cricket World Cup today entered the second round of group matches. We were still awaiting the first big weather problem, still awaiting the first big upset, none of which seemed to bother England as they prepared to face Kenya under threatening skies at Canterbury. After all, England had looked in great form in their opening match against Sri Lanka, especially Alan Mullally with 4 for 37. And captain Alex Stewart with 88 runs. Graham Hick had secured the 8-wicket win with a shot that underlined England's authority. Kenya had lost to Zimbabwe by 5 wickets, but all-rounder Thomas Odoyu had showed that they still demanded respect.
That is a magnificent stroke.
For Kenya, the 500-to-1 outsiders weren't expected to prevent England, making it the perfect 2 wins out of 2 start to this competition. Chris Lewis is with us to give us his verdict on what happened at Canterbury today. England made one enforced change from the side that beat Sri Lanka, Robert Croft coming in for Adam Holyoake because a stiff neck would prevent Graham Hick bowling his off-spinners. Kenya's only change from the defeat by Zimbabwe was to replace seamer Jimmy Kamande with left-arm spinner Mohammed Sheikh. Heavy overnight rain and a wet outfield delayed the start at Canterbury for an hour and a half. Alex Stewart had won the toss for a second time, and unsurprisingly, given the damp atmosphere, he'd put Kenya in. We join their innings in the first over, one without loss. The commentary team, Jonathan Agnew, Mike Atherton, Chris Broad, Peter Lever, Dermot Reeve, and first of all, Richie Beno. It's Gough to Sharp.
Mark Elam is the man down at deep third man. Oh, very well on Friday against Sri Lanka.
And that's it. A leg braai bringing England victory. Nasser Hussain receiving congratulations from the Kenyan fielders. Graham Hick likewise. Angus Fraser getting all the scenes on video. And a mini invasion from the happy English supporters we've had here at Canterbury. Comprehensive victory to England. Alex Stewart out on the field. Pat on the head for Nasser Hussain. And this game has been played in a wonderful spirit. The Kenyans having to go out and field in damp conditions with a wet ball after we had a brief stoppage for rain. They've added to the occasion.
So the England batting, only 3 players required. The rest must be getting just a little impatient. Nasser Hussain, 5 short of his best ever one-day international score. Graham Hick, his second big innings in the competition, not out on both occasions. And the Kenyan bowling, not exactly figures they'll treasure, but
Evening, you've been out all day and you've missed the FA Cup final and also a remarkable one-day test at the Oval. Well, the football's on BBC One a lot later on, and we will have over the next hour highlights of both today's matches in the Cricket World Cup. 12 months ago, England was celebrating a Test series win over South Africa. But in the one-day world, the Rainbow Nation has match winners wherever you look. Lance Klusener, the all-rounder supreme. Jonty Rhodes, Rottweiler with the bat, whip it in the field. Alan Donald, nobody does it better with the ball. But three of England's Lions have been in good form so far. Graham Hick has yet to lose his wicket. Alan Mullally, swing bowling at its best. And Darren Goff, fast and furious with attitude. Also today, Zimbabwe going for their third win against defending champions and facing the exit door, Sri Lanka. Well, there were 17,000 at the Oval today for whom events at Wembley were but a minor distraction. Let's look at the group before this match between South Africa and England. Absolutely crucial, as you can see. Both teams unbeaten, but the South Africans top on run rate. And if Zimbabwe were to win today, they'd go above the losers in this England game. One change for England from the team that beat Kenya. Angus Fraser brought in to boost the attack at the expense of Ian Austin. Nasser Hussain still viewed as Alex Stewart's best opening partner. South Africa were unchanged. I don't suppose their selection meetings last too long. Hansie Cronje confirmed today, incidentally, as the next supremo of South African cricket, and he'll still be captaining the team at the same time. Well, a blowy but a bright day in South London. England won the toss and decided to field, and we're going to join it in the first over of the day. There's no score. Gough bowling to Kirsten, and our six-strong commentary team is Jonathan Agnew, Dermot Reeve, Barry Richards, Viv Richards, Mike Atherton, and, first of all, Richie Benno.
Close.
Welcome to day 12 of the Cricket World Cup. Only one match on the schedule today, but England against Zimbabwe at Trent Bridge had taken on a lot more significance than England would have liked. When Darren Goff bowled Sean Pollock at the Oval on Saturday morning, it looked as if England's perfect start to this World Cup could continue. But when Alan Donald trapped Graham Thorpe on Saturday afternoon, it was part of a batting collapse that had England revising their World Cup ambitions. It meant that victory against Zimbabwe or India was essential to progress to the Super Six. Zimbabwe should have been the easier opposition, but they'd beaten India in the big surprise of the tournament. So two of the three qualifying places from Group A were very much up for grabs, but whoever won at Trent Bridge today would effectively be through. England against Zimbabwe had become a very big match. Mark Ramprakash is here to examine what happened at Trent Bridge today, where England made one change to the side beaten by South Africa. All-rounder Adam Holyoake coming in for off-spinner Robert Croft in a bid to strengthen the England batting that collapsed so badly at the Oval. Zimbabwe, who have had wins against Kenya and India, make one change to the side beaten by Sri Lanka at the weekend. Mbwanga coming in for Brands, one seamer replacing another. England won the toss, put Zimbabwe in conditions at Trent Bridge that look set to suit the seamers. We join it at the start. Commentary from Jonathan Agnew, Chris Brawl, Dermot Reeve, but first of all from Mike Atherton with Jack Bannister.
First ball of this crucial Group A game, Darren Goff to Neil Johnson. And away. Four leg byes.
And this will avenge, says one or two of those rather high profile defeats that England sustained in Zimbabwe. There it is. Fitting that Hussain should hit the winning run. England romping to victory. More than 11 overs to spare. They've won by 7 wickets. And certainly helps their cause now in qualifying for the Super Sixes. They had to win here today. Neil Fairbrother finishing on 7 not out, but Hussain on 57.
Very good day for England. Important runs for Graham Thorpe. Classy stuff from Nasser Hussain. A rare slip-up from Hick. Stewart a little unconvincing again, but England coasting home for the loss of 3 wickets. 69 balls to spare. Zimbabwe's bowlers, Mwanga was the pick of those with figures of 2 for 28 off 7. But England, their third win of this World Cup, should be enough to guarantee their place in the Super Six. Alan Mullally, man of the match for his fine bowling performance. England back on course, but a big setback for Zimbabwe.
Alistair, you had much the worst of the conditions today. It was a good toss to win for Alec, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. I think we saw that yesterday with New Zealand and West Indies as well. I think these tosses are crucial. I mean, it did zip around, but fair play to England. You still got to bowl well on them, and they did do that. Mullally bowled fantastically, I thought, and we were just too many runs shy in the end.
And then the sun came out when they batted.
Yeah, I mean, it flattened out into a really good deck. I mean, it still did a bit for the first 10 overs with a new ball, but flattened out into a really good deck, and obviously 160 was nowhere near enough.
Do you feel now your destiny's in your own hands? Have you got to win your last match?
Well, we have to, and it's against South Africa, you know, who we've never beaten, who are probably, you know, playing the best cricket out of any country in the World Cup so far. So it's going to be a tough game, but, you know, we've got nothing to lose, so we're going to go out there and try and get those extra 2 points and try and get 6 points.
We had a hiccup Saturday against South Africa. Today, there'd been a lot of talk in the papers, a lot of people had said things, but I thought today we let the cricket do the talking and we played very well.
Good toss to win, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's always nice to win the toss. The ball darted around, but as I've always said, you've got to put the ball in the right place. Alan Mullally led the way, but backed up by everyone else.
Are you worried at all about the fifth bowler?
No, I thought, you know, the fifth bowler went for less than 50 today. The ball swung around. Andrew Flintoff ended up holding the ball across the seam and worked it out well. And Adam Holyoake is a good bowler, a lot of variation. He's not the tallest bloke. We can still get the ball in the block hole, and I thought he did a good job.
And confidence-boosting 50s from Hussain and Thorpe.
Yeah, I mean, we all know how good of players those two are. Nasser played very well against Kenya, and he's carried on that form today. And Graham Thorpe's been in top form all season.
Are you worried about your own form at all?
No, 88 against Sri Lanka, and then 12, 20 odds. I know, going all right. The new ball darts around a little bit, but looking forward to the next game.
You're nearly there now, aren't you? I mean, you need a good finish against India for the first group stage.
Yeah, it'd be nice to win the next game at Edgbaston. There'll be a lot of support both for England and India, and we're looking forward to it.
So the Group A table, slightly better reading for England. There is a way in which they could still miss out on qualifying. If they're beaten by India, and India also beat Sri Lanka tomorrow, and Zimbabwe beat South Africa on Saturday, England would miss out because they'd only beaten one of the other three on 6 points. But a good performance against India at Edgbaston on Saturday would finally dispel all the doubts. Mark Ramprakash, let's forget the details. They're going to make it, aren't they?
Yeah, I think so. The guys, I think, would spirits have been lifted, certainly by a good win today. It was a good, efficient performance. The bowling is looking very good. But I think I would just like to see some more of the middle-order players get a chance, get a knock before the Super Sixes.
The bowling has looked good throughout this competition, and today it was Alan Mullally, the star man.
Yeah, he's been performing well throughout the tournament. It's been an interesting idea not to give him the new ball. But he came on today and was bang on target, and he's bowled a very searching line. Believe me, those deliveries there are quite difficult to leave. The right-hander's got to play at them just in case they nip back. And he's been a very crucial performer coming on just after, say, 10, 12 overs and getting those vital wickets.
And he got so much out of the conditions today, didn't he?
Yeah, the ball did dart around, as I say, but the slip-catching was good. England took their chances. And if they continue to do that, then they'll certainly be a force to be reckoned with.
Alan Mullally, man on form. Where do you stand on this question of the specialist fifth bowler, though? It's going to be important from now on.
Yeah, I think it's a very difficult predicament. And England have often had this, not just in one-day cricket, but in five-day cricket, perhaps adding depth to the batting. Do they go into the game with a bowler light? I think against the better sides, they could pay for it. Alec was there saying that, you know, the fifth bowler only went for under 50 today, but against New Zealand with wickets down, perhaps they should have done a bit better than that. We'll have to wait and see, but perhaps Robert Croft would be an option to give England some variety in their attack.
But you would do what? Stick with Holyoake and Flintoff? Certainly for India on Saturday, maybe.
Yeah, I think the game's at Edgbaston, the ball might continue. This white ball, there's been a lot of debate about it. It might continue to move around. And I think they've got a hope that Adam Holyoake and Flintoff, between the two of them, can get it right.
Bowling, no big problems at the moment, and the batsmen informed today. Nasser Hussain in particular, Graham Thorpe as well. And what Hussain adds is this great spirit in the field. And you've got particular admiration for fielding like this, I know.
Yeah, I think the key here is not this, how quick he's released the ball. I mean, he's in mid-air there, and that's been the crucial thing. He's managed to run out the guy because he released the ball so quickly. And his fielding uplifts everything. And he's playing a vital role at the top of the innings, perhaps a role that Michael Atherton would have played. And he's got the technique and the class to open the innings and hopefully be sort of the anchor man role, really.
And both he and Graham Thorpe timing the ball superbly today. Alex Stewart still a wee bit out of touch with the bat.
Yeah, Alex not quite been at his best. His footwork perhaps is, you know, not as confident or as assured as it has been in the past. But he is absolutely right. The white ball does dart around and it's not easy batting up the top of the order. I think that's why Nasser's been up there, you know, just to provide some solidity, I think.
We're going well at the moment. Super 6, here we come. Mark, thanks very much indeed. Tomorrow it's more action from Group A, Sri Lanka against India, both chasing that qualifying spot for the Super 6. South Africa versus Kenya in Amsterdam, a match with novelty value. Maybe it'll go into the history books as well. But live coverage principally of Sri Lanka against India at Taunton, 10:30, BBC 2 tomorrow. But today at Trent Bridge, England repaired the damage, some of the damage they suffered at the Oval. Big performance against India would repair the confidence as well. Bye for now.
Good evening. The third weekend of the Cricket World Cup, by the end of which we'll have said goodbye to six of the teams. But which six? If it comes down to run rates in England's group, then maybe India have the box seat. Their three musketeers have been the stars of the show so far. Ganguly, Dravid, and the little master, Sachin Tendulkar. England's men with a mission are Darren Goff, Alan Mullally. Their task to stop the Indian run machine. Also today, everybody's favourite, South Africa against Zimbabwe, still hoping to sneak into the last six through the back door. Well, four seasons in one day today, as you'll see a bit later on, and if you don't actually know what happened in the two matches, believe you me, by the end of the programme, you will be on tenterhooks. Let's see what the group looked like before this latest round of matches. South Africa already through. Two of England, India and Zimbabwe will join them in the Super Sixes. For England, it was the same 11 that beat Zimbabwe, so four specialist bowlers in the side and Adam Holyoake and Andrew Flintoff making up the remaining 10 overs. For India, Nayan Mongir recovering from a hand injury and he resumed behind the stumps. No place for the all-rounder Robin Singh, despite his five wickets against Sri Lanka. Well, amazingly, Alex Stewart won the toss for the fifth group match in a row, and he put India in to bat. Beautiful sun to start with. It's one without loss, and Goff bowling to Ganguly. Our commentary team is Jonathan Agnew, Chris Broad, Ravi Shastri, Dermot Reeve, Mike Atherton, and first, Richie Beno.
Are now discussing the situation because there is a definite amount of movement in the crowd. And there is a fair amount of rain falling. Tarvin Akhtar and Daryl Hare are the two umpires, consulting with the third umpire, or match referee. And they, of course, have a second day to play this match, to finish this match. Sure, they will want to get it through, if possible, in one day. If the weather conditions don't allow, then they have a second day to play. But they've decided to play on for a little while anyway.
Well, two things will happen here. The wicket will moisten up under this rain, but also the Indians will have a wet ball to contend with. That'll even up the conditions.
Well, that's Steve Rouse, the Warwickshire groundsman. He's prepared to bring the pitch covering on. but not quite yet. Sourav Ganguly is the man coming on at the pavilion. So here's an important innings for the Lancashire left-hander, Neil Fairbrother. Well, neither of these umpires have a great deal of knowledge of local conditions here, so Darrell Hare is asking the groundsman, Steve Rouse, for his opinion. I think he's probably telling him, get off, give me a chance to cover up the pitch if it gets any heavier. Well, they've decided that enough is enough. The rain falling, you can see it on the back of Darrell Hare's jacket there, the rain falling on the pitch is obviously going to make it more interesting for bowlers than for batsmen. So to be fair to both sides, he's decided to take the players off the pitch for the moment.
Well, if you were watching the Middlesex Sevens at Twickenham earlier on today on BBC Two, the ensuing storm will be very, very familiar to you. Torrential rain on the most dramatic scale, bringing play to a premature close. So the match balanced on a knife edge to be resumed and resolved tomorrow. And just how vital will that third wicket prove to be? And didn't England have some luck as well when it came to some of the playing and missing that went on there? But they do have a fair amount of batting to come against an attack that's often been described as lightweight. The target is effectively 160 in just under 30 overs. And the weather, of course, could be a crucial factor tomorrow. Will conditions continue to help the medium pacers? Prasad conceding just 8 off his 5 overs today, but the fifth bowler has still to enter the attack. And the rest of that match you can see tomorrow during the course of Sunday Grandstand. Plus, of course, Australia against the West Indies. And that is win or bust for both those teams. As it was today for Zimbabwe against South Africa. Harare or bust, I suppose you could say, for them. Now let's look at the South African side. Unbeaten, unchanged. They resisted the temptation to give everyone a game, despite being assured of qualification and having enjoyed that resounding triumph over Kenya in midweek. But two changes for Zimbabwe. Off-spinner Andy Whittle and leg-spinner Adam Huckle brought in for Paul Strang and paceman Mpumelelo Mbangwa. Well, the Zimbabwe captain, Alistair Campbell, won the toss, and he decided to bat. So with run rates in mind, not only did Zimbabwe's batsmen have to contend with Donald, Pollock and the rest, they also had to score quickly over those crucial first 15 overs. And Neil Johnson, once a Natal teammate of Pollock and Rhodes, ensured they did just that.
Terrific shot, 4 more. This is a wonderful start for Zimbabwe.
After 3 days' rest, more available in the case of England, the Cricket World Cup resumed today with the first match in the Super Six, Australia against India at the Oval. The group stage of the competition had separated the top 6 sides from the rest, England firmly among the rest. India had finished off England's World Cup challenge on Sunday morning at Edgbaston, but equally their involvement was also hanging by a thread.